טרקטד בבא בתרא, פייג' 157 עד המשנה, about to get close to the end of this מסכת. Here we are, Long Island, New York. Pleasure to be here. Welcome everyone, God bless you. Welcome all those people who watch us. It's pleasure to get all your comments, emails, phone calls. Thank you. Here is a story I would like to share with you, a true story. Happened in Israel. A fellow that live in the city of Bnei Brak in Israel get a phone call from a secular attorney. He was kind of scared. He says, you have to come to my office right away. He said, is anything special? He says, no, I have a good news for you. So he traveled from that small city of Bnei Brak to Tel Aviv. And that attorney said, I have few documents you need to sign and I have an envelope for you. What is it? It was an elderly lady that somehow by the end of her life was connected to several people in Bnei Brak, and she heard about this Torah scholar and she decided to give her apartment to him. So that attorney, secular attorney, was sure that the fellow will be very, very happy that he gets this type of Yerusha, this inheritance. But to his great surprise, he was shocked to hear the fellow said, excuse me, I want to see the will, what exactly she wrote. And he said, the attorney said to him, what's wrong with you? You should be happy. You get this large amount of money, we sold that apartment. And the fellow said, no, I need to see the will, I need to see exactly, I need to examine it by my rabbi. So he took it to his rabbi, and the rabbi checked it with him, and he said, sorry, you don't have, which we learned in several days, called ma'ase kinyan, which means she did not have the formal matter of acquisition between her or her attorney, her estate to that fellow. And therefore, since she have a children, he cannot possess that apartment. And the fellow said, the righteous fellow said, I don't want that. If it's not meant to be mine, I don't want that. The story is fascinating because later on, he gets about the same money from different source. So the whole story is fascinating. If you want to hear more, one of the luminary rabbis in Bnei Brak, his name is Rabbi Asher Kowalski. He is the one I heard this story from, and it's fascinating. It's very connected to our subject today. So basically what we're going to do from here to the end of the perek, the end of this chapter, is the law of the inheritor and the heir, the one who basically gave and the one who inherited, and a situation like, unfortunately, both of them passed away and it's not clear who is the one who has the right for the inheritance. Here is the Mishnah. One case. Nafal ha-bayit alav ve'al aviv. Imagine a situation. It was a house and the house collapsed, unfortunately, on the son and his father. So it means, let's use name, Reuven and Yaakov. The house collapsed on them and they passed away. Or alav ve'al morishav, which is Reuven and his brother or his uncle, the brother of his father, which Reuven is the closest kin to them. So now Reuven passed away and one who is supposed to have the inheritance from him passed away. And we are not sure who is the one who passed away first. והייתה עליו כתובת אישה ובעל חוב. So the son have the responsibility of what? Of marriage contract to his wife and to pay a creditor. And the son had no money with which to pay those, that because it was all notion that he's going to inherit it from his father. And here is the conflict. יורשי האב אומרים, הבן מת ראשון ואחר כך מת האב. The inheritor for the father said, the son passed first and then the father. So it means that Reuven did not inherit anything, nothing from his father's estate. ובעלי החוב אומרים, however, the creditor said, say, האב מת ראשון ואחר כך מת הבן. The father passed away first, and then the son passed away. So it means Reuven inherited the estate of Yaakov, his father. So it means that that's basically a, in a way, lien or subjugated to pay off the debt. Here you see a disputation between the house of Shammai and the house of Hillel. Beit Shammai omrim yachaloku. Beit Shammai said you have to divide the estate between each party. So what happened is that the father's heir received half of the property and the son's creditor received the other property, other half. Ubeit Hillel omrim nechasin bechezkata. So the Beit Hillel hold that the estate retains its previous owner status. Why? Because you have here the knowledge of the last owner, and the last owner of the property was the father. So therefore, you give it for the father's heir. It's called in Ivrit, Ein Safek Motzi Midei Vadai, something that you are in the predicament, in the dilemma, you cannot make out of something that is definite. So now the Gemara starts with the next Mishnah, which we're going to study in Mitzvah Shem on page 175, Tnana Tam. We learn over there. Hamalveh et chaverot beshtar goveh minchasim mishuabadim. A fellow who lends money to another with that promissory note can collect the debt even from the lien property that has been sold. Al yedei edim. If one lends money only with witnesses, goveh minchasim nechorim, he collects the debt only from unsold property. Bai Shmuel, the iknei vekana mao. Shmuel asks a question. If the borrower wrote on a promissory note, the property that I will acquire in the future shall be lien to this debt, and subsequently acquire property. So what's the halacha? אני בדי רבי מאיר דאמר אדם מקנה דבר שלא בא לעולם לא תיבא אלך. If you go by Rabbi Meir that said that a person can transfer ownership of entity that not yet come to the world, it's not the issue. Why? Because they have the place and lien on the property. The ודאי קנה. אלא כי דיבא אלך עלי בדי רבנן דאמרין אדם דבר מקנה דבר שלא בא לעולם. So if you go by the sages that said a person cannot transfer ownership of entity that is not yet come to the world. So how come you tell me that he can put a shiabud, put a lien of something that is not yet in his estate? So based on that, the late Tzanze Rebbe, in his book Yatziv Pidgam, asked a question. How come Yaakov took the Bechorat, the firstborn, from Reuven and gave it to Yosef? It's something that דבר שלא בא לעולם. So the Tzanze Rebbe in Yatziv Pidgam explains that he has said that when it's come to Koach HaTzibur, the Koach HaTzibur is like the public rights, is such a powerful thing that they can transfer ownership, even something can do aknaya, even something that is not yet in the world. So the same notion as melech poretz lo gader ben mochim biyado, that the king can do whatever he wants and no one avoided him. So therefore, you hold the same thing. So the Midrash Rabbah explained that Yehuda said to Yosef, our father was in a way king in the land of Canaan. So since Yaakov considers some type of king, so therefore, he can go and do this type of thing, can transfer the firstborn from Reuven to Yosef, even it's not come to the world yet. But in a book called Parashat Drachim, he explained this disputation based on the Gemara we study in Tractate Shabbat, page 55b. So the Gemara there said that if Reuven was seen, that's the famous machloket between Rashi and the Rambam, if Pilegesh is in the time of the Kiddushin or without Kiddushin, the Rashi said it is Bekiddushin Pilegesh. So since Yaakov betrothed Bilhah, so it means Reuven sinned when he basically cohabited with the wife of his father. But according to Rambam, he said that Pilegesh is not Kiddushin, so Reuven did not sin because it's not considering Eshet Aviv. So therefore, you will understand why Yaakov took the firstborn from Reuven, because he basically combined Bilbel Yetzuei Aviv. Well, because here you have the notion that Reuven cohabited with the Pilegesh of his father, so it means that you have to go by the Rambam that Pilegesh is go without the matter of Kiddushin, so therefore he's not considering the wife of his father. So therefore, if Yaakov is in the category of Melech, so otherwise he cannot take Bilhah without Kiddushin. So therefore, Yaakov said, according to your view that I'm considering in a category of king, I can do Maaseh Kinyan from Yosef, even the firstborn, even that's something that is not Baal HaOlam yet, because you did Maasecha Garmu Lafsid Et HaBchorah, you did cause to lose the Bchorah. That's the Parashat Drachim. Anyway, Amar Rav Yosef Tashma, that's Gemara in Ketubot, page 110. So here the Gemara said that they're dealing with someone who produced a promissory note against the other, and the borrower produced a bill of sale dated after the promissory note that states that the lender sold him a field of his. So you have the admon that said that the borrower can say, well, I really indebted to you. You should have collected the loan when you sold me the field. והחכמים אומרים, זה היה פיקח שמחר לו את הקרקע, בני שיכול למשכנו עליו. They said that it was a very smart lender, because now he can take the field and as a collateral from him, in lien of the outstanding loan. So the Gemara rejected, אמר לרבה, מיני כאמר, מיני אפילו מקדים הדקתי תפי, even from the basic one from one on his shoulder. Kikami Balan the Ikne Kana Umahar the Ikne Kana Vorish Mai. So if he acquired property and bequeathed this to his heir, what's the halacha? Can the lender repossess the property from the buyer or heir? Amarabhana Tashma, Nafala Bait Alav Alaviv, Alav Al Morishav, Aitalav Ktubad Ishao Balchov, Yurshav Umrim Bet Rishon Vahagach Metav, Ubalechovot Umrim, Av Met Rishon Vechule. So that's basically the notion learned in Mishnah. If you tell me that he hold, I acquire property and sell it to others, the ikne can have a wish lamishtabet. Nei nami the av mit mereisha dikneu. Amar leRav Nachman zeira chavrin tirgema mitzvah leitumim lifroach chovat aviem. It's a mitzvah incumbent upon the orphan to repay the father's death. Matkif laRav Ashi milve al pehu. So Rav Ashi hold. And he said that the promissory note does not place the lien on a property. So it's loan by basically oral agreement. Rav Shmuel Damrit Ravai Umil Valpe, Eno Gove Lo Min Harashim Velo Min Lakochot. So both Rav and Shmuel hold that this is oral agreement, and if it's an oral agreement, you cannot collect it, neither from the children, from the heir, nor from the buyer. 157b, אלא המני רב מאירי דאמר אדם מקנה דבר שלו בעולם. As we said at the beginning of the sugya, the Rashbam explained that all idea of ספק, the quandary, is only follow the view of חכמים, because according to רב מאיר, you cannot make any שיעבוד of something that is איקנה already. אמר רב יעקב מן ההר פקוד משמד רבין התשמה. This is the Mishnah in Tractate Shvi'i, chapter 10, Mishnah number 5. שטרי חוב המוקדמים. So here we talk about promissory note that, in a way, dated prior to the date in which the loan actually was given. So he said psulin, it's invalid. Vamucharin, ksherim, if it's written later for the time of the loan, it's okay. Visagratach di ikne kanav machar di ikne kanav vorish lo mishtabed mocharin amai ksherim. So why you tell me that the one you written in the post-dated promissory note is valid? De iknehu, so it's basically acquire. Shall be lean. So Amani Rab Meir Damar Adam Makne Devar Shalom. That's according to Rab Meir that said the person can transfer ownership on entity that is not yet come into the world. Omar Rav Sharshi Mishmed Rav Atashma L'Shevach Karkaot Keitzad. When it's come to enhancement the land, how does it happens that the debt cannot be collected from lien property that has been sold? הרי שמחר שדה לחברו והשביחה. If someone sold a field to another fellow, for example, he put zeveli, he put enhancement on the field, and he plowed it, and he planted it, etc. ובא בעל חוב וטרפה. And then the one who was the creditor came and repossessed from the buyer. כשהוא גובה את הקרן מנכסים משועבדים, when he collected the very basic principle from a lien property, ואת השבח, whatever enhanced, מנכסים בני חורים, from the unsold property. So they said here, the Ritvain, קצות החושן, נחלת דוד, few others that challenged that. Anyway. ויסגל את אחדי קנה קנה ומחר, די קנה קנה ובוריש לא משתעבד, בעל חוב ומאי קובע שבחה. How come the creditor collect here the enhancement from the buyer? Since the enhancement was not extend to the time of the loan, it's not lien. המאני, גמור יסד רב מאיר, אמר אדם מקנה דבר שלא בעלם. That's go by the רב מאיר. He says a person can do that, can be transfer ownership to an entity that is not yet come to the world. So the dilemma of Shmuel is basically raised, follow the view of the Chachamim. אם תמצא לומר, if you tell me, דאיקנה קנה ומחר דאיקנה קנה ובוריש לא משתעבד, הל לא משתעבד, אם תמצא לומר משתעבד, לבא, ולבא וחזר וקנה מהו? לכמה משתעבד או לבטרה משתעבד? What exactly he basically acquire? The first lender have lien upon the property, or does the last lender have lien the property? אמר רב נחמן, המילתא היא באה אלן ושלחו מטעם. It was basically sent someone from Eretz Israel, and they give a response to that, and he said Rishon Kana, the first one is the one, the property is basically linked to the first Baal Chov, the first creditor. Ravuna Amar Yachaloku, Ravuna said that they split according to the amount of the loan that was given, and is no kdima to any one of them. וחנתני רבא ברבו יחלוקו. אמר רבינה מהדורה כמה דרבה שאמר לן, ראשון קנה מהדורה בת רדרבה שאמר לן יחלוקו, ובלכתה יחלוקו. So basically go by the הלכה that they divide the property between them. מייטי ולשבח קרקעות כיצד. So now they ask a question, enhancement, how does it occur the debt cannot be collected from the lien property that has been sold? הרי שמחר שדה לחברו וישבחה, if someone sold an estate to his fellow and the property enhanced, הוא בא בעל חוב וטרפה, and it happens that the creditor came in and repossess it, כשהוא גובה את הקרן מנכסים משועבדים, he take the principal from the lien property, ואת השבח, whatever enhanced, מנכסים לחורים from the unsold free property, ואם היא תחצי שבח מבעלי, and if you tell me that the buyer should collect only half of the value of the enhancement, my gove name de katani. So what exactly when you said in the Braita, they used the term the gove, that the buyer collected the enhancement. What does that mean, gove? So the Gemara said chatzi shvach, that you basically collect half of that value of the enhancement, but it doesn't mean that he collected the entire shvach. And that's basically the way the Rambam said. The Rambam said in the Ilchot Milveh Velovesh, chapter 2, consider a case where the buyer writes that the property has, that he will acquire, shall be lien, and he subsequently sells his property, which is then enhanced by the buyer. When the lender repossesses the property from the buyer, he also repossesses half of the enhancement of the property. That's basically also the Shulchan Aruch Choshen Mishpat in 115.